How to help someone, a child or a young person, who is struggling with their mental health. Now, we know that in any one year, around 20% of young people will have some sort of mental health problems. And it is so difficult to know how to help them, how to approach them, when and how to start these very difficult conversations, and when it is something that is seriously wrong, and when it's just growing up. So unfortunately for a lot of young people, some of the sort of the signs that something might be wrong, such as becoming more withdrawn or changes in behaviour, changes in mood, can actually be a normal part of growing up. But it's understanding and recognising when some of these are signs that they could do with a bit of extra help. Now, we know that the majority of mental health issues do develop in children and young people. So that's when their sort of formative time is happening. And the quicker we can identify that there is a problem or a potential problem and get them some help, the better it is for them. So really important to understand some of the signs to look out for. And also to realise when to have the conversations, how to have them, and what and where you can signpost them to get the help that they need. So we've been working with Maudsley Learning, and we've been developing our own mental health first aid courses as well, to go into more detail with some of this information. I've also got a blog post that I will be posting underneath this Facebook Live that will give you even more signposts and click resources that may be helpful. Particularly in the current climate, we have a lot of children who are very stressed and anxious, and anything we can do to help them is an absolute blessing. So first of all, when to approach them, and think as well, are you the right person to be approaching them? By all means, start the conversation, but if it's quite obvious that you're not the right person, then be understanding about that. Don't take it personally. It's about getting them the right help that they need. So if you're not the right person, then maybe try and help them to identify who the right person might be, and open the conversation in a non-judgmental, purely caring manner, so that you know, they feel empowered to go and get some help. And it might be just that as the first step. You may need to go slowly. And also think about when you're having conversations. So for example, if it is that you are slightly worried that your child might have issues with eating or developing some sort of an unhealthy relationship with food, then don't start the conversation during mealtimes, because mealtimes will be a highly stressed environment. So start the conversation when you're on neutral territory, you're more relaxed, and nobody feels sort of threatened by what is happening. Now, there's quite a helpful structure to having these conversations. We call it the CARES approach. So once you've sort of realised the right time to have the conversation, and you've put some time aside where you're not going to be disturbed, then you should think in the back of your head, this sort of structure, it may be helpful. So first of all, check that there is no immediate danger and no life-threatening crisis. Obviously, if they are, you know, having serious suicidal thoughts, or they have seriously self-harmed, or they are not in touch with reality and could be a danger to themselves or to you, then you need to escalate that. That's where confidentiality needs to be breached, and it's the only time when confidentiality should be breached. So check there's no immediate danger. If they have self-harmed and there's basic first aid you can do, then you could administer that. Calmly approach them, reassure them, and in the back of your mind, just sort of assess what's going on and be ready to help. And then Listen. Actively listen. Try not to jump in with suggestions. Be as calm and reassuring, but don't tell them it's all going to be okay. And don't try and give them all the answers all the way through. So just think with nice positive body language, and also try not to reflect your opinions on them. You might be thinking, good grief, you have everything going for you. You are the luckiest child in the entire universe. But actually, that's not how they're feeling. And that's not what's going on. So put everything to one side and listen. Listen to what they're saying. Don't judge, don't jump in, and just understand. Understand and just check back that you have understood appropriately. So totally non-judgmental. You can recommend immediate help. So once they've finished going through, if there's, you know, perhaps it's their schoolwork that's causing the major additional stress that's making their problems worse, then perhaps you can work out together a solution around that. Or maybe it's helping out at home that's causing them stress. Maybe it's helping with younger siblings. Maybe it's helping because they're a home carer. So all sorts of other things. If there's immediate practical help that you can do, then that might help just ease some of the stress. Encourage them to seek professional help. And that's where some of the resources that you can read about below can be really helpful. There are so many different ways that they can get help. And it may be that a properly moderated chat room is a good first step, or a discussion with the GP. There's all sorts of things, but it's them and they have to embrace it and they have to feel ready. And you can also suggest and help with other support options. So that's where a lot of the other charities and things and the other resources, again, that I will link in the blog post, can be very helpful. So there's all sorts of places that they can go for help, from, you know, from your GP type of side of things through to privately. There's counsellors, there's different sorts of counsellors and talking therapy, there's medication, there's all sorts of different rehabilitation, some that involves the whole family, some that doesn't. Everything is there. It may not always be as easy to access as you would like. Confidentiality is absolutely critical. You are earning their trust. If you breach their trust, then your relationship will be damaged for it. So ensure that that confidentiality is out there. And the only time you breach that is if you are seriously worried about something life-threatening. And then in terms of moving forward, make sure you retain your boundaries. Don't treat them any differently, because those boundaries are important. So don't go all soft on them. You know, you can be extra kind, but those boundaries have to stay, because also they will give them a degree of structure that they will respect and work around. If they're feeling out of control, that element is important. Always be calm and practical. Let them know that you love them to pieces and you care about them. And be there for practical support. It may be that it's driving them to different appointments, even if you're waiting outside. But there's lots of things that you can do to be there for them. It's really tricky for kids and parents and teachers and family and friends at the moment, particularly difficult. With schools going back and forth, it makes it even more stressful. A lot of people struggle with change. And boy, have we got change and, you know, flip-flaps going on all over the place. So hopefully some of these things will help give you a structure. As I say, we've got comprehensive online courses. We've got additional practical help, and we've got some really useful blog posts that are rammed full of resources. So I hope that's been useful. Please share if it has been. That's Emma Hammett from First Aid for Life and onlinefirstaid.com.